وآل محمد. عن فاطمة الزهراء عليها السلام بنت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله قال سمعت فاطمة عنها قالت دخل علي علي أبي رسول الله في بعض الأيام فقال السلام عليك يا فاطمة فقلت عليك السلام قال إني أجد في بدني ضعفا فقلت له أعيذك بالله يا أبتا من الضعف فقال يا فاطمة ائتيني بالكساء اليماني فغطيني به فأتيته بالكساء اليماني فغطيته به وسرت أنظر إليه وإذا وجهه يتلألأ كأنه البدر في ليلة تمامه وكماله فما صل على فما كانت إلا ساعة وإذا بولدي الحسن عليه السلام قد أقبل فقال السلام عليك يا أمة فقلت وعليك السلام يا قرة عيني وسمرة فؤادي فقال يا أمه إني أشم عندك رائحة طيبة كأنها رائحة جدي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله فقلت نعم إن جدك تحت الكساء فأقبل الحسن نحو الكساء فقال السلام عليك يا جدا يا رسول الله أتعذن لي أن أدخل ماءك تحت الكساء فقال عليك السلام يا ولدي ويا صاحب حوزي قد أذنت لك فدخل معه تحت الكساء
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل
فما كانت إلا ساعة وإذا بولدي الحسين عليه السلام قد أقبل وقال السلام عليك يا أمة فقلت وعليك السلام يا قرة عيني وثمرة فؤادي فقال لي يا أمة إني أشم عندك رائحة طيبة كأنها رائحة جدي رسول الله فقلت نعم إن جدك وأخاك تحت الكساء فدنا الحسين نحو الكساء فقال السلام عليك يا جدا السلام عليك يا من اختاره الله أتذن لي أن أكون معكما تحت الكساء فقال وعليك السلام يا ولدي ويا شافع أمتي قد أذنت لك فدخل ماءهما تحت الكساء فأقبل عند ذلك أبو الحسن علي بن أبي طالب فقال السلام عليك يا بنت رسول الله فقلت عليك السلام يا أبا الحسن ويا أمير المؤمنين فقال يا فاطمة إني أشم عندك رائحة طيبة كأنها رائحة أخي وابن عمي رسول الله فقلت نعم ها هو ما ولديك تحت الكساء فأقبل علي نحو الكساء فقال السلام عليك يا رسول الله أتعذن لي أن أكون معكم تحت الكساء قال وعليك السلام يا أخي ووصي وخليفتي وصاحب لي ردائي قد عظمت لك. فدخل علي تحت الكساء. ثم آتيت نحو الكساء فقلت السلام عليك يا عبتا يا رسول الله. أتعزن لي أن أكون ما أكون تحت الكساء؟ قال وعليك السلام يا بنتي ويا بضعتي قد أذنت لك فدخلت تحت الكساء. الله فلما اكتملنا جميعا تحت الكساء أخذ أبي رسول الله بطرف الكساء وأومأ بيده اليمنى إلى السماء فقال اللهم إنا هؤلاء أهل بيتي وخاصتي وهامتي لحمهم لحمي ودمهم دمي يؤلمني ما يؤلمهم ويحزنني ما يحزنهم. أنا حرب لمن حاربهم وسلم لمن سالمهم وعدو لمن عاداهم ومحب لمن أحبهم. إنهم مني وأنا منهم فاجعل صلواتك وبركاتك ورحمتك وغفرانك ورضوانك علي وعليهم وأذهب عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. فقال الله عز وجل يا ملائكتي ويا سكان السماوات إني ما خلقت سماعا مبنيا ولا أرضا مدحيا ولا خمرا منيرا ولا شمسا مضيئا ولا فلكا يدور ولا بحرا يجري ولا فلكا يثري إلا في محبة هؤلاء الخمسة الذين هم تحت الكساء.
اللهم صل على محمد.
فقال الأمين جبريل يا ربي ومن تحت الكساء؟ فقال عز وجل هم أهل بيت النبوة ومعدن الرسالة هم فاطمة وأبوها وبعلها وبنوها. فقال جبرائيل يا ربي أتذن لي أن أحبط إلى الأرض لأكون معهم سادسا؟ فقال الله نعم قد أذنت لك. فحبط الأمين جبرائيل فقال السلام عليك يا رسول الله. العلي الأعلى يقرئك السلام ويخثك بالتحية والإكرام ويقول لك وعزتي وجلالي إني ما خلقت سماعا مبنيا ولا أرضا مدهيا ولا خمرا منيرا ولا شمسا مضيئا ولا فلكا يدور ولا بحرا يجري ولا فلكا يثري إلا لعجلكم ومحبتكم.
اللهم صل على محمد.
وقد أذن لي أن أدخل معكم فهل تعزن لي يا رسول الله؟ فقال رسول الله عليك السلام يا أمين وحي الله إنه نعم قد أذنت لك. فدخل جبرائيل معنا تحت الكساء.
اللهم
فقال لعبي إن الله قد أوحى إليكم يقول إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم الرجس أهل البيت ويطهركم تطهيرا. فقال علي لعبي يا رسول الله أخبرني ما لجلوسنا هذا تحت الكساء من الفضل عند الله. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وآله والذي بعثني بالحق نبيا واستفاني بالرسالة نجيا ما ذكرنا خبرنا هذا في محفل من محافل أهل الأرض وفيه جمع من شيعتنا ومحبينا إلا ونزلت عليهم الرحمة وحفت بهم الملائكة واستغفرت لهم إلى أن يتفرقوا. فقال علي عليه السلام إذا والله فضنا وفاز شيعتنا ورب بالكعبة. فقال عبي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله يا علي والذي بعثني بالحق نبيا واستفاني بالرسالة نجيا ما ذكر خبرنا هذا في محفل من محافل أهل الأرض وفيه جمع من شيعتنا ومحبينا وفيهم محموم إلا فرج الله همه ولا مغموم إلا وكشف الله غمه ولا طالب حاجة إلا وقضى الله حاجته. فقال علي عليه السلام إذا والله فزنا وسعدنا وكذلك شيعتنا فازوا وسعدوا في الدنيا والآخرة ورب الكعبة.
Please recite the Surah Fatiha for the soul of Marhum. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah.
جو حضرات ابھی بھی دور بیٹھے ہیں ان سے گزارش ہے کہ تھوڑا قریب آ جائیں مجلس کا ماحول بنا لیں اور اب مجلس فوراً شروع ہو رہی ہے. خواتین حضرات، جیسا کہ آپ کے علم میں ہے آج ایم ایم ہاشم صاحب کی 40 کی مجلس ہو رہی ہے. یہ ذات جو کہ خود اپنی ذات میں ایک انجمن تھی، اس نے تمام اپنے زندگی میں کمالات کے مظاہرے کیے، مومنین کی مدد کی، اور آپ دیکھ رہے ہیں کہ ان کی اولادیں، ان کے بیٹے ڈاکٹر نسہری، بابر علی صاحب، ان کی بیٹیاں ہر شعبے میں ادارے کی کمیونٹی اور جہاں جہاں بھی ہیں اپنی خدمات انجام دے رہے ہیں. انہی کے خاندان کے ان کے بھتیجے مرزا محمد عباس صاحب جو ایک عالم دین ہیں آج مجلس سے بھی خطاب کریں گے. اور آپ کو پتہ ہے کہ اگر ایک خاندان میں ایک عالم دین پیدا ہو جائے تو اس پورے خاندان کی، اس پورے خانوادے کے لیے مغفرت کے لیے کافی ہوتا ہے. تو مجھے زیادہ روشنی نہیں ڈالنا ہے کیونکہ آپ بخوبی واقف ہیں کہ یہ خاندان کس طرح سے بڑھ بڑھ کے خدمات انجام دے رہا ہے، اور اس میں خاص طور سے ایم ایم ہاشم مرحوم اور ان کی اہلیہ کا بڑا کارنامہ ہے، انہوں نے اپنی اولادوں کی اس طرح سے تربیت کی کہ وہ ہمارے بیچ اس طرح سے خدمت انجام دے رہے ہیں. آج آپ نے دیکھا کہ ہم نے قرآن خوانی سے پروگرام شروع کیا، اللہ کا نام لیا، اس کے بعد قبلہ مہدی آغا صاحب نے حدیث سے قصہ کی، پنجتن پاک کا تذکرہ کیا، یہ محفل بابرکت ہو گئی. میں ایک چھوٹا سا سلام پیش کرنے جا رہا ہوں جو عظمت نماز سید الشہداء بیان کرے گی، اور اس کے بعد لطفی صاحب سود سلام پیش کریں گے. صلوات
اللہم صل علی محمد و آل محمد وعجل فرج.
یہ کلام استاد جوش کا ہے، آپ لوگ اکثر لوگوں کو پتہ ہوگا. مائک کا کچھ سمجھ نہیں. کیا نماز شاہ تھی، ارکان ایمانی کے ساتھ، کیا نماز شاہ تھی، ارکان ایمانی کے ساتھ، زر دل بھی جھک جاتا تھا ہر سجدے میں پے شانی کے ساتھ، دل بھی جھک جاتا تھا ہر سجدے میں پے شانی کے ساتھ، کیا نماز شاہ تھی، اہل بیت پاک کی ہر سانس کو اے مدعی، اہل بیت پاک کی ہر سانس کو اے مدعی، ہاں ملا کر دیکھ لے آیات قرآنی کے ساتھ، ہاں ملا کر دیکھ لے آیات قرآنی کے ساتھ، جو دل بھی جھک جاتا تھا ہر سجدے میں پیشانی کے ساتھ، یہ فقط دست خدا کی انگلیوں کا کام تھا، یہ فقط دست خدا کی انگلیوں کا کام تھا، حضور باب خیبر توڑ ڈالا کتنی آسانی کے ساتھ، باب خیبر توڑ ڈالا کتنی آسانی کے ساتھ، دل بھی جھک جاتا تھا ہر سجدے میں پے شانی کے ساتھ، کان میں اصغر کے شہ نے کچھ کہا اور وہ ہنسا، کان میں اصغر کے شہ نے کچھ کہا اور وہ ہنسا، حضور بخشش امت لکھی ہے تیری قربانی کے ساتھ، بخشش امت لکھی ہے تیری قربانی کے ساتھ، جو سر بھی جھک جاتا تھا ہر سجدے میں پیشانی کے ساتھ، کیا ستم ہے کہہ رہے تھے 700 کرسی نشین، آج دیکھیں گے سرے زینب کوریانی کے ساتھ، آج دیکھیں گے سرے زینب کوریانی کے ساتھ، جو دل بھی جھک جاتا تھا ہر سجدے میں پیشانی کے ساتھ، حشر میں کام آئیں گی آنسو غم شبیر کے، حشر میں کام آئیں گے آنسو غم شبیر کے، حضور آگ دوزخ کی بجھائیں گے اسی پانی کے ساتھ، آگ دوزخ کی بجھائیں گے اسی پانی کے ساتھ، دل بھی جھک جاتا تھا ہر سجدے میں پیشانی کے ساتھ، کیا نماز شاہ تھی. صلوات. حضرات، اس عمل کے لیے آپ سے بار بار گزارش کی جائے گی، کیونکہ آج ایک عزادار ایم ایم ہاشم صاحب کے 40 کی مجلس ہے. ایک بار پھر سے گزارش کرتا ہوں کہ سورہ فاتحہ 3 بار سورہ اخلاص کی تلاوت کر کے مرحوم کی روح کو بخش دیں. اب میں لطفی صاحب سے گزارش کروں گا کہ سوز و سلام پیش کریں.
ایک درود بھیجیں محمد علی محمد.
اللہم صلی علی محمد و آل محمد و عجل فرجہم.
اور ایک درود بھیجیں محمد و آل محمد.
اللہم صلی علی محمد و آل محمد و عجل فرجہم.
آئے شہد و جہاں خدا حافظ، اے محمد کی جان خدا حافظ، اے محمد کی جان خدا حافظ، ہم شبی ہے نبی حسین کے لال، اکبر نوجوان اکبر نوجوان خدا حافظ، پائے مال غم و علم خاصے جاؤ
شبر کی جا،
جاؤ شبر کی جا، خدا
حافظ
شہدی کے تشن لب یاور، ازغر بے زباں، ازغر بے زباں، خدا حافظ اے علم دارے فوج عباس، اے علی کے نشا، اے علی کے نشا، اے علی کے نشا، خدا ہو گئی آج ختم مہمانی، شیعوں کے مہمان، شیعوں کے مہمان، شیعوں کے مہمان، خدا حافظ شہد و جہاں. صلوات جب صدر زی سے گر پڑے، عباس با وفا جنگل سے آئی گریہ زہرا کی بھی صدا، اکبر نے دوڑ کر شہ والا سے یہ کہا، چلیے حضور محل میں مارے گئے چچا، چلیے حضور محل میں مارے گئے چچا، بے دست دشمنوں نے کیا اس دلیر کو، روائیے ترائی میں حیدر کے شیر، روائیے ترائی میں حیدر کے شیر کو، یہ سنے کے پیٹتے ہوئے اٹھے زمین سے شاہ، فرمایا ہے غضب میرے بچے ہوئے تباہ، یہ کیا کہا کہ آنکھوں میں دن ہو گیا سیاہ، مظلوم سے بچھڑ گئے ابا سارا، مظلوم سے بچھڑ گئے ابا سارا، مدت ہوئی تمام سکینہ کے چین کی، توڑا فلک نے آج کمر، توڑا فلک نے آج کمر کو، توڑا فلک نے آج کمر کو حسین کی، یہ کہے کہ سو نہر چلے شاہ کربلا، مانندے بیت کاپتے تھے شہ کے دست و پا، امامہ تھا نہ فرق پر نہ دوش پر ودا، تصویر وارتے ہم تن سبت مصطفیٰ، تصویر وارتے ہم تن سبت مصطفیٰ، مختل کی خاک سے تنے انور ہٹا ہوا، سینہ کھلا ہوا تگر ماما، سینہ کھلا ہوا تگر ماما، سینہ کھلا ہوا تگر ماما، ہٹا ہوا پہنچے جو ہی ترائی میں، بادی دے پورا لکھا تبا ہے خاک پہ فرزند بو تراب شانوں پہ کی نظر تو جگر کو رہی نہ تا
بس ہائے بھائی کہہ کے گرا وہ
بس ہائے بھائی کہہ کے گرا وہ
بس ہائے بھائی کہہ کے گرا وہ فلک جنا
بے کار دستوں پاتھے شہ خوش خصال کے
لے آئے لاش تک علی اکبر
لے آئے لاش تک علی اکبر
لے آئے لاش تک علی اکبر سنبھال کے
مور کے خون بھرے ہوئے چہرے پدی صدا بھیا حسین آیا ہے آواز دو ذرا اے ہاتھ دونوں ہاتھ بدن سے ہوئے جدا
بازو کے صدقے ان تیرے شانوں میں میں فدا
بازو کے صدقے ان تیرے شان بازو کے صدقے ان
تیرے شانوں کے میں فدا
بھیا ہمارے ہاتھوں بیکار ہو گئے
تم ہاتھوں کے جا پر تیار
تم ہاتھوں کے جا پر تیار
تم ہاتھوں کے جا پر تیار ہو گئے
سن کر صدا حضرت شبیر نامدار کھولا لہو بھری ہوئی آنکھوں کو ایک بار سر رکھ کے پائے شاہ پہ یہ بولا وہ زیب خان
تشریف آپ لائے زہے
تشریف آپ لائے زہے جی چاہتا ہے یہ کہ نثار حضور ہو
کس طرح اٹھ کے گرد پھر اونچ
کس طرح اٹھ کے گرد پھر اونچ کس طرح اٹھ کے گرد پھر اونچ
چور ہو
فرمایا شہ نے کس لیے روتے ہو زار زار لو اب کچھ اپنا حال کہو تم پہ میں نثار کیا جی پہ ہے بنی جو تڑپتے ہو بار بار
کی عرض اس جرین کے ہے وقت اعتذار
کی عرض اس جرین کے ہے وقت اعتذار آقا سے چھوٹنے کا خلق ہے غلام کو
پاؤں گا آپ کہاں شہ گرد و مخا
پاؤں گا آپ کہاں شہ گرد و مخا پاؤں گا آپ کہاں شہ گرد و مقام کو یہ کہتے تھے کہ پھر گئی آنکھوں کی پتلیاں ہچکی کے ساتھ آ گئی سوکھے لبوں پجا حسرت سے دیکھ کر طرف شاہ انسو جا
دنیا سے کوچ کر گئے ابا سے نا جا
دنیا سے کوچ کر گئے ابا
سے نا
دنیا سے کوچ کر گئے
ابا سے نوجوان
چھوڑا جرین سا شہ مشرقین کا
ایک گل اٹھا کے مر گیا عاشق حسین
ایک گل اٹھا کے مر گیا عاشق حسین
ایک گل اٹھا کے مر گیا عاشق حسین کا
چلاتی ہے یہ زوجے عباس نامور چھوڑو مجھے خدا کے لیے پیٹنے دو سر وارث میرا گزر گیا لوٹا جل گھر
ہے یتیم ہو گئے دونوں میرے
ہے یتیم ہو گئے دونوں
میرے
ہے یتیم ہو گئے دونوں میرے پردیس میں علی کے پسر سے بچھڑ گئی اب خاک اڑانے دو میری ماں اجڑ گئی اب خاک اڑانے دو کہ میری ماں اجڑ گئی
مجھے بتایا گیا ہے کہ ابھی بھی کافی لوگ باہر کھڑے ہیں اگر ان تک میری آواز جا رہی ہے تو ان سے دستبستہ گزارش ہے کہ وہ اندر تشریف لائیں مجلس شروع ہو گئی ہے ایک اعلان سماعت فرمائیں اگلے ہفتے سیٹرڈے آج ہی کے دن نیکسٹ سیٹرڈے 6:30 بجے قرآن خوانی ہوگی امین بدر امین کی والدہ کی سال کے سلسلے میں 6:30 بجے قرآن خوانی اور 7 بجے مجلس ہوگی آپ حضرات سے گزارش ہے کہ زیادہ سے زیادہ تعداد میں شرکت کریں جو جن تک آواز نہیں پہنچی ہے اگر وہ کوئی ان کو کہہ دے وہ پلیز اندر تشریف لائیں تاکہ مجلس رونق رہے اور بیچ میں ڈسٹربنس نہ ہوتا رہے اور آخر میں چونکہ امام ہاشم صاحب کی 40 کی مجلس ہے ہم سب مل کے بارگاہ رب العزت میں دعا کرتے ہیں کہ اللہ ان کو جنت فردوس عطا کرے اللہ ان کے درجات کو بلند کرے اور ایسے عزادار حسین سید الشہداء کو ان کی فیملی نہیں بلکہ پوری کمیونٹی یاد کرتی رہے گی اور سلام کرتا ہوں میں ایسی روح کو اس ایک مصرعے کے ساتھ محب آل نبی کو کہیں بھی دفن کرو محب آل نبی کو کہیں بھی دفن کرو یہ خاک جا کے در پنجتن سے ملتی ہے یہ خاک جا کے در پنجتن سے ملتی ہے بلا کسی تاخیر کے اب میں گزارش کروں گا مولانا مرزا عباس صاحب سے جو کہ مرحوم کے بھتیجے ہیں اور ایک عالم وعمل دین کے عالم ہیں اور ابھی انہوں نے ایک مجلس پڑھی تھی 40 کے پہلے اور تمام مومنین سے مجھ سے کانٹیکٹ کیا تھا رابطہ کیا تھا کہ بڑی تشنگی رہ گئی اور ان کو بار بار بلانا چاہیے تو آپ کی گزارشیں پوری ہوئیں آپ کی دعائیں پوری ہوئیں اور آج ہمارے بیچ میں مولانا مرزا عباس صاحب ہیں اب ایک بابا دے برن سلوات بھیجیں اس کے ساتھ مولانا سے گزارش اللہم صلی اللہ محمد
اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم الحمدللہ اولہ بلا اول کان قبلہ وآخرہ بلا آخر یکون بعدہ الذی قصرت عن رؤیتی ابصار الناظرین وجزت عن ناتی اوہام الواصفین ثم الصلاۃ والسلام علی سیدنا ونبینا حبیبنا وطبیب نفوسنا اشرف الانبیاء والمرسلین اب القاسم المصطفی محمد وعلی طیبین الطاہرین المعصومین المظلومین سیما بقیت اللہ العظم بقیت اللہ خیر لکم ان کنتم مومنین ولعنۃ الدائم علی ادائہم اجمعین من اعلان الى قیام یوم الدین اما بعد السلام علیکم جمیعا ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ the 40th of my uncle Marhum, M.M. Hashim ibn Mirza Abdul Jawad Rahmatullah Alayhi, is very different to the 40th that we commemorate for Abu Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam. The memories are quite fresh because we just come out of the month of Safar, in which we commemorated the Arba'in Husseini, which also happened to be the day of the demise of my uncle Marhum, the 19th of Safar. I just want to point out to the Masaib in the beginning, I don't know why, because as my brother just mentioned, there was Quran, there was zikr of Ali Kisa, Panjatan, then the Marsiya of Imam Hussein, the Salam of Imam Hussein, and the Marsiya of Abul Fazl, and we missed out on Sayyidah Zainab Salamullah Alayha. If you can just imagine that our mothers and sisters are behind this wall here. If I just bring someone out from there and here in front of all, what sort of feeling that all of you would have, with all due respect, the daughter of Ali and in front of that is why it says aman from that heart which is in istirab, aman as dil Zainab. I mean, here the men can imagine, you and I are imagining right now, that how bad that is really to see our ladies, let's say they are wearing hijab, without him hijab, but imagine what is going on in their heart, the istirab that they have. So the 40th of Imam Hussein alayhi salam and the importance of that points out to all of these calamities that befell upon the Ahl Bayt alayhi salam, the trials and tributes which the heart of Hussein went through was very different to the trials and tributes which the heart of Zainab went through. Shahadat, being deprived of water, Zainab also went through all of that, the pain and suffering. But coming in front of men and people who are half drunk, people who are fasiq, and a personality like Zainab, what that heart have gone through. Our scholars, there's Ayatollah Sibawi, very famous scholar, he says that for Masaib of Zainab Salamul Aliha doesn't really require any sort of mentioning of the whole narrative, but rather just imagine that in the courtyard of Yazid, Zainab's name was called and she was asked to enter. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. The 40th tend to have that value of Aba Abdullah Hussein, and that's why we always emphasize upon the Arba'een of Imam Hussein alayhi salam compared to other Masumeen or even sort of our Marhumeen as well. And the trend that we find within all sort of Asian and Iranian and even Iraqi Arabs is that they not to do the 40th on the exactly 40th, but the 10 days before, few days before, they tend to commemorate or tend to have a majlis of tarheem for the marhum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless marhum and increase in his daraja and mahshur him with Ahl Bayt alayhi salam. The levels of akhirah and the hereafter, which the Quran clearly points out to, Ya ayyuha an-nas innaka kadihun ila rabbika kadhan famulaqi. O insan, you're on a journey towards meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now this mulaqat, famulaqi, there is one mulaqat which happens while a person is still here in this dunya, in this world, where he comes out of his low desires, of his nafs, and meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't really wait for that mulaqat. And the marahil and the levels of that is very similar to the levels of that mulaqat, that a person dies and meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why the Prophet have said, Mata anta qabla mutu, die before you die. So death is a gateway towards that mulaqat. Now, if someone wants to understand the different levels of this meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is very much required that he should focus upon the stations or the levels that are mentioned in regards to the perfection of soul, where an insan meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this dunya itself. So when he reflects on these stations that are mentioned within the risalas, within the Quran, within the hadith, within the spiritual teachings of the scholars that are extracted from the du'as, for example, then he would be able to comprehend and understand the significance and the importance and the different levels of what a soul really goes through after he dies. Because that is a mystery. And to really acquire that, to really understand that, what that soul goes through, one should focus upon that spiritual reality or the spiritual perfection of the soul as he lives within this dunya. Because it's mulaqat at the end of the day. So when we look at the spiritual teachings, we tend to find 40th tend to have a very unique composition, the number 40. You know, within the Islamic teachings, 40 have a very unique composition, a very, very unique sort of figure that have been mentioned in the Quran. For example, the Quran clearly says that at the age of 40, there is shukufaye aql, which means that the aql reaches its perfection. And Hazrat Ibrahim acquires that, O Allah, provide me with the reality of understanding or doing the shukr in the proper way and transferring that to my zurriya, to my children. So at the age of 40 is mentioned in that very verse where the intellect reaches its perfection. And at the same time, we have many traditions that points out to. For example, in Ahya Ulumuddin of Imam Ghazali, which tends to mention the issue or the hadith of the Prophet, which is also brought in the hadith and other Shia traditions as well, that the clay of Hazrat Adam alayhi salam was in preparation for about 40 days. And then after that, finally it was prepared, Adam was made. So that number 40 tends to have a complete cycle, you know, of a completion, of a perfection. So when a soul leaves this dunya and enters that realm of barzakh, it takes about 40 days for that soul to really adapt to the surroundings and to really achieve that station. See, as it says that man akhlasa arba'ina laylan or naharan, meaning that a person who purifies oneself, a person who brings about ikhlas in his actions for 40 days and 40 nights, he will reach to a station where his heart will gush out wisdom and knowledge. So it requires a 40 days of dedication of hours to the scriptures, to the teachings of Ahl Bayt and the Quran. If one really dedicate oneself, that whatever he's carrying out with sincerity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
He's taking care of halal and haram and mustahabat, so on and so forth, for only 40 days. After that 40 days, automatically his heart will spring out or will gush out knowledge and hikmat.
It is
so he achieves that station after 40 days, after 40 days of khulus. Now obviously when the soul departs and leaves this world, he is in the hands of the malaika, he is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That really purifies that soul, where he has surrendered to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where he has accepted the fate and he has given a welcome by, as we tend to believe, by Amirul Mumineen, by Masumin alayhi salam, who will attend to the person who is about to enter Barzakh. So he has given labbaik to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has entered that realm, and now for that 40 days, that takes that purification of that marhum, where he tends to adapt to that surroundings. Then you have other traditions on the basis of the Quran itself. وَوَعَدْنَا مُوسَى سَلَاسِينَ لَيْلَةً وَأَتْمَمْنَاهَا بِعَشْرٍ. Musa was promised for 30 nights, and then we increase this 30 with 10 more in order to make that 40. And after that 40, it brings about that Tawrat, those commandments was provided to Musa alayhi salam. So once again points out to that number 40 there. Hazrat Yunus alayhi salam, once again in the belly of the whale, where he says, وَظَنُّونِ اِذْذَهَابَ مُغَادِبًا فَظَنَّا نَقْدِرَ عَلَيْهِ فَنَادَ فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. That's how he called, or that's how he sort of seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the belly of the whale for 40 days. And then after that, he was given that daraja, that level where he achieved, for example, that shore was brought. Then the 40 days of Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam is also mentioned in regards to the flood, and he was continuously asking Rabbi Anzilli Munzala Mubarakan Wanta Khairun Munzilin Bih, that, oh Allah, you know, provide me with a shore, with a manzil where is Mubarak, and I reach there. And he asked for 40 days, and eventually was. So therefore the number 40 is very important. And obviously the greatest of all 40 is really that Arba'in Husayni, in which, once again, see, you link this 40, as 40 has its importance, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have to provide and point out to the maximum amount of reality and haqiqat that one could really reach of that 40, that is nothing but the Arba'in of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, where all souls, even including, as according to the tradition that we find in Kamil al-Ziyarat, one of the most authentic book of hadith, that even Anbiya and Awliya and Afzalul Anbiya and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala achieves or attend Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam from the Arsh on the 40th. Therefore, it points out to that reality. And for instance, we tend to find many of the great scholars or the Urafa who have written, for instance, in their risalas or in their books, the four levels of an insan, of a human being, or the four quwa, or the four realities of him, such as his intellectual reality, quwa aqliye, quwa wahime, for instance, his rational capacity, quwa ghazabiye, for instance, his sort of anger that he has, quwa shahviye, the lust and shahwat that he has. He has to really conquer all these four, and all these four have 10 marahil or 10 levels to it. Once he conquer all that four, he reaches that ultimate perfection, once again pointing out to that number 40. The same thing applies, as I was just, was pointed out to the recitation of the Quran, and indeed a blessing. Thank you to the brother who mentioned nice hadith in regards to the Quran, where the zikr of four birds of Hazrat Ibrahim been mentioned, that you know, chapter Juz number 3 have that discussion, and I was reading that, in which talks about those four birds and killing of those four birds. Obviously, this also have its own marhala and marahil, perhaps, of those 10 levels. And these four birds are also symbolize of different realities that is in regards to insan. Just for our youngsters, for our children, I'll just mention this, perhaps they can take this story, you know, with them, and they can remember that. If you help me with the salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Hazrat Ibrahim asked that he wants to see that how Allah raise from death, the Qiyamah. Then Allah said that, don't you believe in that? You know, he's the Ulul Azm prophet. You know, but he really wants to see. You know, seeing is something else. For what? لِيَتْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِ. In order that I have itminan in terms in my heart. That tranquility and itminan. When I see it, I will have that itminan. So finally, the Quran points out to four birds. But our sixth Imam, he describes in the hadith in more detail what these birds were and what these birds were symbolized as. Obviously, pointing out to that four and the 10 levels and the marahil on the basis of the Risala of Bahrul Uloom, which have been mentioned, Risale Bahrul Uloom. So here, these four birds, our sixth Imam says that one of them is a peacock, the other is a crow, and the third is a pigeon, and the fourth is a rooster. The sixth Imam says that. So, O Ibrahim, you mince them up, you kill them, put them on different sort of mountain, and then you call them and they will come back to you. Obviously, this is symbolized as something as according to the sixth Imam. He says that the first bird, which is pointing out to peacock, for instance, O Ibrahim, if you kill your arrogance and the marahil of arrogance that it has, obviously, even, for instance, where it talks about arrogance, it could be that, yes, you know, we are the one who are vilai, we are the one who are the true believers. But on the other hand, it could become ujub, it could become self-righteousness, that we are the best and no one else. And while doing so, we might do something or we might hurt someone that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't really want us to do. Where Allah has not left the Anbiya and Awliya, Hazrat Yunus alayhi salam, thought that they are the lost nation and that the curse be on them. Who is he? He is the prophet. And he thinks they are the lost nation. You know, they are useless. Let the curse be on them. What happened to Yunus alayhi salam? Wasn't he really in a way punished, so to speak? Or he was rectified in a way? That is why we tend to recite in Munajat Shabaniya, we say, A'udhu bika min ghadabik wa hululu sakhatik. O Allah, I really seek refuge from your ghazab. You know, this ghazab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this avenge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it could be on a given time where I have committed something haram, na'uzu billah, for example. You know, as the fourth Imam says that, you know, four things are hidden behind four things. You know, the azab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is hidden behind sins, regardless of that sin be big or small. Oh, it's a small sin, let's commit it. No, the azab is hidden behind it. The istijabat of dua is hidden behind dua, whether that be big dua or small dua. The awliya are hidden amongst the men. Do not say that this man, he has this beard, he looks more nurani, he's a waliullah. No, it can't be so. The awliya are hidden among the men themselves. So therefore, respect each and every person, right? So therefore, the issue is that the ghazab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sometimes where a person commits a sin, or sometimes the ghazab is in order to really teach a lesson, where we tend to see in regards to the stories of the Prophet that, for instance, Hazrat Yunus alayhi salam or other prophets even that we find, for example, as we are talking about Adad of 40, I just remember this hadith, which is mentioned that in Khisal or in Tawheed of Saduq, where a person comes to Hazrat Amir, who was from Yahud, and he says that we have three questions. If the Prophet answers, we will believe that he is the Prophet. And then Amirul Mumineen related to the Prophet, and Prophet said, come tomorrow, I will inform you. And he forgot to say, Inshallah. And for 40 days, there was no wahi. I mean, if you look at the verses of the Quran, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes have no formalities, even though he's Habib-e-Khuda. But the way he speaks to him sometimes, you would say, oh my God. Right? So therefore sometimes the ghazab, for 40 days there was no, once again that number of 40. So the ghazab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes it could be from the azab, or it could be to teach a lesson to the Prophet and Anbiya and Awliya. So therefore, you know, as we say that the Nabi who was the Prophet, he went through that. And we have to be very careful that we could have that arrogance and this arrogance, that when we are saying proud, we might enter, yes, we are proud to be wilayi. But this could be possible that we enter the realm of self-righteousness. That we could enter the realm of arrogance. You know, the possibility exists. So therefore one have to be very cautious and careful. So that's number one. The peacock, you slaughter that, O Ibrahim, then you will be able to see what is really Qiyamah, how I raise, you know, from death. Then the second one was a crow. And if you look at the qualities of the crow, is it tend to hide a lot of walnuts under the ground of future hopes, long hopes. So one should never have sort of long hopes and plans, but rather do tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. O Ibrahim, you slaughter that bird that you have, which tends to fly with long hopes, then you will be able to see how we will raise from death. Then the third thing he mentions is the pigeon, where the pigeon tend to store a lot of food, which points out to greed. O Ibrahim, you know, slaughter that greed that you have in you, then you will be able to see how I raise from death. Then finally talks about that rooster, which points out to the shahwat of an insan. And if you slaughter that, then you will be able to see that. And obviously one have to really keep one's eye open in these traditions to really reflect and ponder, where we do tend to find, I'll just mention in this in the margin, like for example, one of the mustahab pets to have is a rooster and a pigeon, not a cat or a dog. Unfortunately, these days we have a fashion of having cats, where there are differences of opinion in regards to the hair of cats amongst the maraji. You know, Ayatollah Sistani, perhaps, you know, I would say, you know, with a bit of caution, that he would say that, yes, maybe excessive hair, you know. But other marajis, they say, no. Period. Hair of a cat on body, no namaz. You know, you cannot. So why do we want to entertain something like that? Right? Anyways, so here, you know, Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam was asked that if you really slaughter that rooster, which is pointing out to the shahwat, and having that pet as a rooster of shahwat, the Prophet says that shaitan will play with these birds and will not bother your children if you have them as a pet. You know, there's a lot of symbolism here that one really have to pay to. And we are the people of symbolism, don't we? We have this beautiful zari that we have, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all your du'as and hajat that you do here with the salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So these are the four. So these are the four, once again pointing out to that number of 40 and the 10 different levels that it comes about. So 40 have a very unique composition, a reality to itself that one have to really pay heed to, especially the followers of Ahl Bayt alayhim salam, the people of the path, those who really want to be true followers, that they should really look into these traditions of 40 and try to practice ikhlas and khulus. Now, going back onto the discussion where we started, we said that the marahil of the hereafter, when a person dies, is very similar to the spiritual realities that we read or that we have. For instance, one of the greatest level of the hereafter is that consciousness, is that huzur. Everything in the hereafter will have an ultimate or extreme or 100% of consciousness, that they will be able to see the angels. They are so conscious, they are able to see the angels. They are so conscious in barzakh and hereafter that they would call no one but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help. So, they are that conscious because the consciousness have increased to the maximum capacity. You know, the focus of that person is towards the huzur, towards the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why we tend to find that when that marhum is in that state, he is in that presence of that huzur, although there is people around him, but he is gazed somewhere else. He's in that huzur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's in that presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We might think outwardly that he is not connected, but he is connected the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants him to be connected. And that is why we tend to recite in Munajat of Shabaniya, where we ask Allah that Ilahi Habli Kamalul Inqita Ilayk. Oh Allah, provide me with the perfection in disconnection. Meaning that even disconnection, even disconnecting ourselves from this dunya, have darajat, have levels. So Amirul Mumineen in Munajat is asking, give me that perfection of disconnection. So the marhala of the, or the journey, or the beginning of journey for those who are, you know, for that mulaqat, where they are taken, rather than voluntarily, they go where Amirul Mumineen is asking for perfection of disconnection, is that huzur. You know, that soul tends to have that presence and that huzur, and he starts to see the unseen and the reality, and he starts to focus that. And right after that, that disconnection takes place, that inqita, and the perfection of inqita, which tends to manifest out as inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raja'un. It's completely disconnected from this dunya. But we are thinking it's disconnected, but it is perfectly connected with us. In the perfect way possible, it is connected. It is not connected with those things which are fani, which will disappear and highlight, but it is connected with those things which are baqi. This which you recited, that's the Quran, is this baqi or is this fani? It is connected with this, these things which are baqi and which will remain. As the Quran clearly points out to after Hajj, that la yanalu lahumuha aur damuha, the meat or the blood of the sacrifice will not reach Allah, walakin yanalu taqwa. But what will reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the God consciousness in that sacrifice that you have done. So therefore it gets connected to that ghaib, to that marhum, and that connection is a connection of perfection through that perfect disconnection. You know, disconnection from that materiality, from those material desires, from that emotionalities. That no wonder why the Prophet says to a person who comes and attends to him, and he says that, you know, my desires are not being answered, what shall I do? He says that, you know, do you have your father or your mother, for example? He says that, no, you know, my father is alive, however my mother is marhum. Then he says, okay, be nice to your father, and then and go to the grave of your mother and do dua, you know, connect, and eventually that connection will take place, and he will, your desires will be fulfilled. So that connection is there. Then he leaves, and the ashab says that, you know, the Prophet speaks to the ashab. He says, I wish his mother was alive, you know. Then you would have reached on a greater status by doing by serving the mother, so to speak. Salat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So that connection that takes place, or that remains after this disconnection, is the perfect type of connection, a true connection, a connection of spirituality and spiritual needs and desires and wants, which will always remain. So in this dua, when Amirul Mumineen is saying that Ilahi habli kamalul inqita alayk, O Allah, provide me with that perfection of disconnection, he is asking for that. So the marhala, or the level that this marhum or marhumin enters, is that disconnection once again. You know, they enter that level of complete disconnection. So here we tend to find that what is really for us, for instance, when Hazrat Amir is saying Ilahi habli kamalul inqita alay, what does it really mean? And how can we really have that perfection in disconnection? How can we have that? First and foremost, once again, I'm reminded of that third juz that I recited. We recite, آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه كل من آمن بالله وكتبه وملائكته وكتبه ورسوله. The first and foremost thing in disconnecting ourselves from this dunya, which will take us to the perfection of disconnection like how our masumin had or how the ashab had, is that iman. Allah. Is that iman in the ghayb. You know, iman in the malaika, iman in the books, iman in the rasul. You know, we have to have that iman. And that is the beginning of our disconnection. And when we look at it, all of the ahkam that we have and the practice of these ahkam will build up or will build our disconnection from this dunya. If we start practicing them, if we implementing them in our lives, the ahkam, the wajibat, the muharramat, the mustahabat, gradually and gradually, well, one would start to disconnect from this material world. That disconnection begins. You know, that zuhud, that ascetic soul sort of, it rejuvenates. That is why the Prophet have said that zuhud is really to be thankful of what you got and not to be upset or desire of what people have in their hand. You know, being thankful of what you have been given to you, that is itself is zuhud. That in itself is ascetism. You know, where a person is thankful of what he has. And Hazrat Amir also point out to in the tafsir of the verse that is in Surah Hadid, Lekaila Tasaw Alama Fatakum, where do not be disappointed. Tasaw Taasuf. Do not be disappointed of what is taken away from you. Or do not become happy if something is given to you. The soul needs to be in the state of tranquility, in a state of harmony. That it is not overpowered with joy, so to speak. It is satisfied. And it lives in the present moment. You know, one of the things, to be honest, that we all tend to have an issue with is that we never live in the present moment. We always think of the past or we think of the future. You know, what's going to happen now? You know, it's about this much time. You know, what happened? You know, if we just sit and we start thinking about what happened, and then we leave the present moment. We don't really focus on that present moment. We tend to think of the future or the past. But the present moment is the most beautiful moment ever. And how beautiful that could be if we just keep everything aside, that we are sitting here and we are discussing and we are talking nothing about the Quran and Hadith of Masumin. So when we start focusing on that present moment, that is nothing but huzur itself. Then when you are in that huzur, when you are that presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then how is it possible that a soul could commit an error or commit a sin? Because he is living in that present moment. So therefore, that present moment is very important. That huzur is very important. And the soul, the diseased soul who is about to enter or who have entered, it develops that huzur, that presence, through that disconnection. And that begins to us in our life by fulfillment of the ahkam of ilahi, of the recitation of the Quran, teachings of Ahl-e Bayt alayhi salam. Gradually and gradually, one really have to bring that in oneself. And it kind of, the soul tends to adapt that. And, you know, as Imam Hussain alayhi salam on the night of Ashura, there's a khutbah that he gives, you know, he really gathers the ashab and he thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the end of it. You know, he says that I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ala sarrae wa ala zarrae, in the state of joy, in the state of, you know, sadness, I am thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In every state, I am thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What sort of heart is that? This heart is a heart that is completely disconnected from Allah, from the worldly sort of material realm, but it has connected to the divine. Now, after this disconnection takes place, ilahi habli kamalul inqata, and that is a perfection in disconnection, ilahi habli kamalul inqata alayk wanir absaru qulubina bidhiya'i nadhira ilayk hatta taghriq absarul qulub hujuban nur. Provide me, after that disconnection, provide me to enter or tear past even the veils of light. Forget the veils of Zulumat. Even there are veils of light that one would trespass. So now, whether that be in this dunya, through the help of that 40 that we talked about, the person who, you know, does ikhlas for 40 days and all that, or whether that be after a person dies, he has to really go through all these stages. You know, he has to go through all these stages, principally speaking, for that mulaqat. So that requires, once again, the sincerity to really see these divine maqamat and levels which are trespassing even all of those. Hujub an-Nur, the veils of light, one really have to trespass. And when we reflect that how can this ikhlas and khulus be brought, we tend to see that illa alladhina amanu, as we said, that beginning of this connection is really with that iman, wa amilu salihat. فَلَهُمْ أَجْرُ غَيْرُ مَمْنُونَ or فَلَهُمْ مُخْلِصُونَ. You know, those who have iman, that disconnection takes place. And then وَأَمَلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ with that amal salih, you know, having iman. You know, it's iman. Musalman and then iman, and there are these darajat there. You know, one have to be very careful there. So that's iman. And then after that, that amal salih is also very much required, that when a person carries out that amal-e-saleh, you know, he starts to enter these higher levels. And when we look at this khulus, how khulus is developed, you know, how this amal-e-saleh, that we could bring about khulus in that. We have a hadith from the Prophet who says that, you know, have jalasat or have meetings in which you could invite scholars and discuss and speak to them. You know, people who are Rabbaniyun, scholars who are of knowledge, of wisdom, discuss with them, eventually that khulus will come. Eventually that disconnection will come. Visit a person who is ahle khair, you know, who is good and who always do good, just go visit him. You know, sometimes when you kind of sit with people who are very greedy, who are, you know, money-minded, always thinking about the dunya, you feel so dizzy, you know, you get a discomfort. You know, I recently visited a doctor, you know, in England, I'm talking about. It was like, he came all the way till the till so that I pay his fees, forget his room. You know, it's like, my God, he's like one of the consultant and very sort of, you know, renowned. You know, in England it's a different system. You have a private and then you have that NHS. So in order to go to the private, you got to pay, right? So when I visited him, and he came all the way till the last door, because he doesn't take the debit card, he wants to take cash. So he made sure that I pay him. I said, okay, you know, I will do that. So you feel like, you know, although he's so educated, but sometimes you meet doctors who are ahle khair. You know, you listen about people who go to Najaf and who are there just serving. You know, you just meet them for 2-3 minutes, you feel like, my God, this person is ahle khair. That iman, that khulus, that sincerity kind of comes in you. And you really want to do this, something good, what he is doing. Although that profession, he's a doctor and all that, but he's not, you know, he's money-minded, you run away from. But at the same time, you see a doctor who is ahle khair, who is doing good, you feel like, oh, I want my children to be doctor. You know. So therefore, the Prophet says that, be with the ahle khair, then you will have that, you know, that ikhlas and khulus and of doing amal-e-saleh will come within you, and you will want to do that amal-e-saleh. I remember my marhum, my uncle marhum, who I always used to address in my letters, and, you know, whenever we used to do gift exchange, as my master and my teacher and my father. One of the things that was very unique just now, you know, he was praised and all that. Whenever we sit, he would say that, you know, Abbas, my worth is not even worth than the worm that exists in the gutter. It is nothing but the love of Amirul Mu'mineen and the support of the have-nots have brought me here, of who I am. I mean, if you look at that, he was not a PhD. He wasn't a master's or a graduate. But look at his insight and where he reached. And what he did. I mean, his understanding of his self, although we are praising him, so on and so forth, but he himself, what he thinks of himself, that Abbas, I was nothing but a worm in the gutter. But the support of Amirul Mumineen, the love of Amirul Mumineen, and the support of the have-nots. He would always say the have-nots, those who are mahroom, you know, always help them. And even till today you would find, you know, in India, and people who have called, you know, to really give pursa and so on and so forth, they say, you guys don't know us, but we remember how, you know, Hashim Shah Sahab would sit outside, you know, hours without food, without anything, just to sign, you know, papers for the people in order that they achieve or they get something. So we, that was the insight. So that is a complete disconnection. And at the same time, you tend to find that, you know, that khulus, that sincerity only comes about when one self is regarded as nothing. You know, that is why Ilahi la takilni tarfata aynan abada. That's what the Prophet used to say. Oh Allah, do not leave me by myself alone. Always keep me under your umbrella. If you do that, then I will think of me as something, and then I will lose it. You know, and there was this marhum in Risale Lubbe Lubab. I'm forgetting his name. A great scholar, teachers, you know, grand teacher of Allama Tabatabai and all that. He says that I saw Shaitan, and he took me to a high sort of elevation, like a mountain. And he was like very purified, very, you know, teacher of many sort of spiritual future asatid scholars. He says that, oh, whatever is Ayatullah, if you make a little mistake, do you see how the depth of this valley? I will throw you down there. So Shaitan will never sort of, you know, let us go. He wants to trap us. So if we think of ourselves of something, Ilahi la takilni, ila ghayru. You know, oh Allah, I want everything through you and through your hand. And do not leave me alone even for a one-tenth or one bit. Tarfat aynan, even for that, you know, blinking of my eye, do not leave me by myself. So that is that iman on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that huzur, that presence, and that khulus and amale saleh that one really carries out, that brings about a different person altogether and would reward him. And this sort of disconnection, like we said, when we look at our Masumeen alayhi salam, we tend to find it's on that highest level. Subhan. When we look at that qalb or that heart of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam, what sort of disconnection is that? That is a kamal of disconnection. That is perfection in this disconnection, really. And even it has teared apart that Hujubun Noor, where did this disconnection really started? Just focus on the day of Ashura itself. That disconnection begins with that azan of Ali Akbar itself. That azan of Ali Akbar. That disconnection begins, that pain of separation begins with that attending to Habib ibn Mazahir itself. How many times Hussein have become shaheed on the day of Ashura? One after the other. One after the other. If one just really imagine and just really think about the masaib of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, what he went on that day. Just really think about his masaib. It's one man, one heart. It is very difficult for a son to lose his father. But let me tell you this, it is very difficult for the father to leave behind the son. But look at Hussein. Hussein, who have lost his son, and he is leaving his son as well. Who have lost his friend, who have lost his brother. When Imam Hussein alayhi salam and his kayfiyat and his state of his heart, if you look at it, and the utmost and the peak of that disconnection, of that shahadat of Imam Hussein, really, is that when he raises Ali Asghar alayhi salam. Now, to what level the masaib of Imam Hussein alayhi salam is one really cannot comprehend in one day, in few hours, what this heart went through. when he is attending Ali Akbar, when he is attending Abul Fazl, when he is attending Habib ibn Mazahir, when he is speaking to Hazrat Qasim, when he is speaking to Hazrat Zainab, when he is trying to console Umm Rabab, when he is raising Ali Asghar alayhi salam and trying to take Ali Asghar back 7 times in Lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, in what state is the heart of Imam Hussain alayhi salam? In what state the heart of Hussain is when he is about to leave, a little girl pulls the cloak of Abu Abdullah Hussain and he says, "Oh father, you're leaving us alone in this wilderness, in this desert." In what state the heart of Imam Hussain alayhi salam is? And finally, Imam Hussain alayhi salam, when he goes and battles, and when he falls down from that mount, in what state the heart is? Look at the jumalat of Imam Hussain. Ya Ghiyath al-Mustaghithin. There is no Lord but you, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In your love, O Allah, I have come here and I have brought my family here. And when Imam Hussain alayhi salam is in that qatalgah, look at the heart of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. He looks at Abdullah, who was the son of Imam Hassan alayhi salam, who comes out of the tent and he says that you are killing my uncle. When he raises those hands, these hands were chopped and it falls in the lap of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, and he was shaheed in the lap of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. The last shaheed Abdullah, that is why he's known as Aba Abdullah. In what heart? What is the heart of Imam Hussain alayhi salam? And finally, that hour occurs when he's in that qatalga and shimmer is on the chest of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. Look at the state of disconnection of Aba Abdullah. He says, "Oh shimmer, you know where you are? You're on the chest of Hussain, the chest that was kissed by the Prophet. You have gone quite high, O Hussain. Will you spare me my life? I will guarantee you the shafaat of Rasulullah." This is the heart of Hussain, that who is guaranteeing the shafaat of Shimr by Rasulullah. That is the perfection in disconnection. He wants to save Shimr. "Oh Shimr, you have decided to kill me. Why don't you give me a bit of water?" Do you think Hussain wants water? Not at all. Abada. Hussain doesn't want water. How can he ask for water when Asghar was killed in that fashion by asking water? That is the disconnection. Hussain is trying to point out to a hidden reality, number one, and that is water, which is the right of even animals, and they did not provide me water. No one have the right to usurp, to control of the water. Oh, lovers of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, know that Hussain asked for water, even that water wasn't provided. The water where the animals have the right to drink. And at the same time, Hussain is focusing upon Shimr, that, "Oh Shimr, perhaps if you go with water, there could be some rahm and mercy of Allah upon you, so that you will be saved as well." That is the perfection of disconnection, why they are known as the minarets of mercy. In Ziyarat-e-Jamia, we recite "Wa amana ur-Rahman." The way Rahman is, they are just like Rahman. Then finally, that hour occurs when Shimr moves and wants to slaughter that head of Hussain, who gazes at Zainab, at the Tille Zainabiya. Look at the disconnection of Hussain and the istirab of the heart of Zainab. What Zainab is going through at that moment, where she sees that the decapitation of the head of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, which was not from the throat, but it says it was from the neck, where Hussain is then that sajda, in that state of perfection, of perfect servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is sajda, and his head was decapitated and it was raised on the spear. And look at the heart of Zainab when he reaches to the body of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. And look at this, he raises the body of Imam Hussain without his head. And what she says,
She says, Allahumma taqabbal hadha qaleel. Oh Allah, accept this qaleel, this little sacrifice. Look at the heart of Zainab. The perfection, kamalul inqita ilayh. La lanatullah ala qawm al-zalimeen. سيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون بفاطمة وأبيها وبالها وبنيها وسر المستودع فيها فأجبنا يا الله 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 يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك يا قاضي الحاجات يا كافي المهمات انك على كل شيء قدير يا الله بحق فاطمه سهره سلام الله عليها forgive all of our sins and the sins of our marhumin and especially my uncle marhum Mirza Muhammad Hashim ibn Mirza Abdul Jawad rahmatullah alay, and raise his daraja and mahshur him with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Ahl Bayt alayhi wa sallam in barzakh and hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mahshur all of us and our marhumin with Ahl Bayt alayhi wa sallam in the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala haze the reappearance of our 12th imam and include us as his faithful companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give shifa to jumla mu'mineen and mu'minat, especially those who have requested us for prayers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect the lovers of Ahl Bayt alayhi salam, where no matter where they live in this world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect the religious institutions, particularly the shrines of Ahl Bayt alayhi salam, particularly the shrines in Syria. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect the maraj-e-izam. Rahmallahu man qara'a al-fatiha li arwahil mu'mineen wal mu'minat. Especially marhum maghfoor Mirza Muhammad Hashim ibn Mirza Abdul Jawad rahmatullah alayhi with a loud salwat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad
wa ajil farajah. Aap hazrat se guzarish hai ki tashreef rakhe. Ali Isfahani ghabrayegi, Zainab salam pesh karenge.
Ghabraegi Zainab, ghabraegi Zainab, bhaiya घर जा के कहां पाएगी ज़ैनब घबराएगी kaisa ye bhara ghar hua barbaad ilahi kya tabahi ab isko na baad kabhi paayegi zainab ghabraegi zainab beparda hui آئے پیار جانیے کیا کیا بھی دکھ پائے گی زینب گھبرائے گی زینب پوچھیں گے جو سب لوگ کے بازو پہوا کیا یہ نیل ہے کیسا کس کس کو نشان رسی کے دکھلائے گی زینب گھبرائے گی زینب پھٹ جائے گا بس دیکھتے ہی گھر کو کلیجا یاد آؤگے بھیا دل ڈھونڈے گا تم کو تو کہاں پائے گی زینب گھبرائے گی زینب گھر جا کے کسے دیکھے گی قاسم ہے نباس اکبر سے بھی ہے آس اپنے علی اصغر کو کہاں پائے گی
حسین 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 آج کا پہلا نوحہ قبلہ مہندی آغا صاحب پیش کریں گے حسین 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 حسین
بولے بیٹی سے سب تے پیمبر بعد میرے نہ رونا سکینہ ضد نہ کرنا مجھے یاد کر کے ماں کی گودی میں سونا سکینہ بولے بیٹی سے سب تے پیمبر بعد میرے نام کی زد نہ کرنا مجھے یاد کر کے ماں کی گودی میں سونا
سکینہ
ہم بہت دور جائیں گے بی بی اب نہ صورت دکھائیں گے بی بی ہم اگر یاد آئے گے بی بی تم نہ بے چین ہو نہ سکینہ بولے بیٹی تے پیامبر بعد میرے نارو
سکینہ
زد نہ کرنا مجھے یاد کر کے ماں کی گودی
میں سونا سکینہ
ہم تو سوئے گے ماں بین مقتر یاد میں میری تم ہوگی بے کر پاؤگی میرا سینہ کہاں کر خاک اب ہے بچھونا سکینہ بولے بیٹی سے سبتے بعد میرے نہ رونا زد نہ کرنا مجھے یاد
کر کے
ماں کی گودی میں
سونا سکینہ
بعد میرے تو دکھی یاری ہوگی تجھ کو ایزا بڑی پیاری ہوگی زندگی پھر تجھے بھاری ہوگی تجھ کو ہے خید ہو نہ سکینہ بولے بیٹی بعد میرے نہ
رونا سکینہ
زد نہ کرنا مجھے یاد
کر کے
ماں کی
گودی میں سونا سکینہ
شمر کوڑوں سے دے گا اذیت اور تماچوں سے وہ بھی حمیت تم کو دے گا یتیمی میں زحمت یاد اپنی نہ کھونا سکینہ بولے بیٹی
سے سبتے پیامبر
بعد میرے نہ رونا زد نہ کرنا مجھے یاد
کر کے
ماں کی
گودی میں سونا سکینہ
میری فرخت میں گریا کرے گا یا انہیں یاد آ جائے اصغر ماں کو رونے نہ دینا تو دل بار منہ پہ منہ رکھ کے سو نہ سکینہ بولے بیٹی سے شب پیامبر بعد میرے نام ضد نہ کرنا مجھے یاد کر ماں کی گودی میں
سونا سکینہ
لاش پر میری جب تم لپٹ کر روگی میری اے جان دختر کوڑے مارے گشم رے بدختر ہے یہ سب تم کو سہ نہ سکینہ بولے بیٹی سبتے پیامبر بعد میرے نہ
رونا سکینہ
ضد نہ کرنا مجھے یاد کر کے ماں کی
گودی میں سونا سکینہ
بی بی آئے تمہیں گھر میری یاد رو کے کرنا نہ تم زار و فریاد ورنہ تم پر بہت ہو گی بیداد مار کھانا نہ رونا سکینہ بولے بیٹی سے سبتے پیامبر بعد میرے نہ رونا
سکینہ
ضد نہ کرنا مجھے یاد کر کے ماں کی گودی میں سونا
سکینہ
حسین فرزاد موسی حسین حسین
میں صدا دیتی رہی تو نہ آیا غازی جب ردا سر سے چھنی میں صدا دیتی رہی تو نہ آیا غازی جب ردا سر سے چھنی میں صدا دیتی رہی تو نہ آیا غازی جب ردا سر چھنی میں صدا دیتی رہی تو نہ آیا غازی
جب ردا سر سے چھنی میں صدا دیتی رہی تو نہ آیا غازی
رے آل عمران کہاں اور زندان کہاں یہ پہن قید ہوئی
تو نہ آیا غازی جب رضا سر سے چھینی میں صدا دیتی رہی تو نہ آیا غازی
جب رضا سر سے چھینی
میں صدا دیتی رہی تو نہ آیا غازی
اے آل عمران کہاں اور دار کہاں یہ بہن قید ہوئی
تو نہ آیا غازی جب رضا سر سے چھینی میں صدا دے
ہم کو پانی نہ ملے تیری خوشبو تو رہے تیرے بازو نہ کٹے چاہے مشکی گچ دے یہ مگر ہو نہ سکا تیرے بازو ہے جدا مجھ پہ ہے تش عالبی
آیا غازی جب رضا سر سے چھینی میں صدا دیتی رہی تو نہ آیا غازی
اے آ گئی شام علوں لٹ گئے اہل حرم ریت پر جلتی ہوئی ہو گیا جل گالوں دینے کے لیے تجھ سے ملنے کے لیے آ گئے بابا لی
تو نہ آیا غازی جب رضا سر سے چھینی میں صدا دیتی رہی تو نہ آیا غازی
قید خانے میں قضا جب سکینہ کو ملی قید خانے میں قضا جب سکینہ کو ملی دے کے کرتے کا کفن بچی دفنائی گئی اس گھڑی نام تیرا صورت یاد ہے علی دکھ میں دہراتی رہی
آیا غازی جب رضا سر سے چھینی میں صدا دیتی رہی تو نہ آیا غازی
جب رضا سر سے چھینی
میں صدا دیتی
اب آخری نوحہ آج کا موعید رضا پیش کریں گے
آیا
یا حسین یا حسین یا حسین
یا حسین یا حسین یا حسین یا حسین
یا حسین
یا حسین یا حسین یا حسین یا حسین
یا حسین یا حسین یا حسین یا حسین گونجتی شام غریباں میں یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا گونجتی شام غریباں میں یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا گونجتی شام غریباں میں
یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا
نہ رہے بھائی نہ بیٹے نہ رہے بھائی نہ بیٹے چھن گئی میری رضا میرا کوئی نہ رہا گونجتی شام غریباں میں
یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا
گرتی شام
کے غریباں میں یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا
آسرے جیس کے بہن چھوڑ کے آئی تھی وطن آسرے جیس کے بہن چھوڑ کے آئی تھی وطن میرے پردے کا جسے ماں نے بنایا زامل لب دریا میرے غازی کے ہوئے بازو جدا
میرا کوئی نہ رہا گونجتی شام غریباں میں
یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا گونجتی شام غریباں میں یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا گونجتی شام غریباں میں یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا
وہ جو اٹھارہ برس نوری حجاب میں پلا وہ جو اٹھارہ برس نوری حجاب میں پلا لوٹ کے آؤں گا میں جس نے تھا صغرا سے کہا ہائے برچی سے کلے جا میرے اکبر کا چدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا
گونجتی شام
غریباں میں یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا گونجتی شام غریباں میں
یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا
میرا غازی بھی گیا قاسم و اکبر بھی گئے میرا غازی بھی گیا قاسم و اکبر بھی گئے حرس مہمان بھی گیا ابن مظاہر بھی گئے کس کو غربت میں صدا دوں کربلا یہ تو بتا
میرا کوئی نہ رہا گونجتی شام غریباں میں یہ زینب کی صدا
میرا کوئی نہ رہا گونجتی شام غریباں میں یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا گونجتی شام غریباں میں یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا
ماں نے مقتل میں جسے دلہا بنا کر بھیجا ماں نے مقتل میں جسے دلہا بنا کر بھیجا میرے قاسم کا بدن دشت میں پامال ہوا پال کھولے ہوئے روتی ہوئی لاشے پہ کہا
میرا کوئی نہ رہا گونجتی شام غریباں میں
یہ زینب کی صدا
میرا کوئی نہ رہا
گونجتی شام
غریباں میں
یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا
وہ سکینہ کے جسے پیار تھا بابا سے بڑا وہ سکینہ کے جسے پیار تھا بابا سے بڑا بعد بابا کے ملی جس کو تماچوں کی سزا در جو ظالم نے اتارے خون آنکھوں سے بہا
میرا کوئی نہ رہا
گونجتی شام غریباں میں یہ زینب کی صدا میرا کوئی نہ رہا گونجتی
صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم.